Slazy and Lisa on FM, on DAB, or listen to your heart's content on iHeartRadio. It's the pick of the bunch, 96FM.
Coming up on the podcast today, another episode of Through the Peephole from Quarantine with Ryan Daniels.
John Pinder on the road again. He's not Willie Nelson, but he was in Tammin in the Wheatbelt.
And we talked about those words you get stuck on. Oh, hello, John Pinder.
Hey, Johnny.
Hello, Clazy and Lisa.
You're on the road. Where are you?
I'm on the road. I don't know. I never know where I am. Oh. I'm at a place called Tammin. We did a gig at a place called Tammin.
Yes.
Which is about 3 feet long, as towns go.
That's what I thought. I had a look on the map and it looked teeny tiny weeny.
It's a teeny tiny weeny. You get to the Welcome to Tammin sign, and from the Welcome to Tammin sign, you can see the Thank You for Visiting Tammin sign. It's a very small place. I had a look on the Googler, and it said the population is 202 people, which is, I think, less than there are in my block of flats.
I was going to say, did both residents come to the gig, John?
Were they at the show?
They seemed to pretty much all be at the show.
Right.
Yeah.
It's that small, they don't need a newspaper around here. There's just one geezer that walks around and tells everyone what's happened that day.
Town crier.
To be fair, they would have come from out of town. It's a wheat area.
Yeah, across the wheat
belt. Right. Well, that's where we're staying. We're staying just out of town, which you could fall over in Tammin and land out of town.
Yeah.
And we're one town along. And it's called, the one we're staying at is called Kellerberrin.
Oh, you mean Kellerberrin?
Yeah, I think that's a more appropriate place for a stand-up gig because it sounds a bit like Karl Barron, doesn't it?
Actually, it does. Yeah, true.
Do you know what I mean?
Kellerberrin.
So I'm on the road with Pony Knox from the...
Did
you just have a dig at Karl Barron?
I might have.
It's just a little cheeky stab at Karl there.
Keep going, you with Pony.
Yeah, I heard that. So we nearly went through to the keeper.
I wasn't supposed to draw attention to it, was I?
We love Pony.
it was a little sly one.
So
I've got Pony Knox from the Motherhood, Benny Darsow, who's one of the artists working like road comics in Australia. He's always out all over the place.
Yep.
Yeah.
And Dave Callan.
Yes.
Me and Dave are in the back of the car.
Beautiful.
Mum and Dad are in the front. We've got that kind of vibe.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're in the front talking about, you know, the finer points of the comedy industry. Me and Dave are in the back trying to one-up each other doing silly voices.
Of course.
I was amusing myself with the thought that you and Dave might have taken one of those romantic back-of-tractor rides with the hay bales and everything through the...
Would have loved that.
Yeah.
I heard you before. Farmer wants a wife vibe. I think
not Farmer wants a wife vibe at all. More Doris Day movie. If you are
Doris
really,
Day sort of
yeah.
I think me and Dave would do all right living in a rural place, I reckon.
You reckon you'd be okay?
Yeah, a little homestead. We get on very well.
Oh,
it's very silly.
That's sweet.
We talk gibberish. He told me we were driving past a lot of fields of canola. You know, I like a whimsical thing to look at now and then.
Of course.
Especially if you're on a long, long trip. So I'm enjoying the fields of canola. Dave saw it and thought it was the roof of a supermarket.
You
know, it's bright yellow against everything. And then he told me not to tell anybody.
Too late. Well, it's either that or a Clive Palmer song. No, if it's all yellow.
He says, what's that? Is it an Aldi there?
An Aldi.
field of canola that day, Dave.
Hey, John, if you're in Kellerberrin, you're not far from Cunderdon and my old stomping ground of Meriden. These are great little towns, mate.
Yeah,
all those sort of places. And I've done them places before, but I never know where I am. I often have to ask the rural people where I am, and it doesn't seem to matter. When I was doing those mining gigs and everything, you'd ask anybody where you were, and no matter where you were, they'd always tell you you were 200 k's out of Kalgoorlie.
You would have had
where am I at the moment? Yeah, 200 k's out of Kalgoorlie.
Out of Cal. You would have had to.
Yeah, it's always the answer.
Would have had to drive right through Meckering, home of our biggest ever earthquake.
Oh, have you had an earthquake?
We had a whopper.
That was in the late 60s.
In the 60s.
Yeah.
Meckering. You would have driven through it, I reckon. And
it sounds very sacred.
Yeah, well, you would have driven on the Meckering earthquake fault line.
I did not know that.
Look for it when you go going back.
Yeah, it's very difficult to find a fun
just
fact.
Just pass
in Tammin,
the Aldi
let me
roof.
Tell
you. You're just trying to find a beer.
Yeah. We went into the pub place at the motel where we're staying.
As you do.
And that was a wonderful moment for me because when you come to Australia as an English person, when you're a little boy and you've watched Crocodile Dundee, you always think that that's what Australia is going to be like.
Yeah.
And then you get here and it's not like that. But then
Until
you get to Kellerberrin, and it is a bit
it's
like
just
that.
Like
it was
that.
Like
it's all Priscilla.
Yeah, there was a man with a big cowboy hat at the corner of the bar.
Yep. Yeah.
And it was like one of them moments, you know, in a Western when you walk into a saloon and the piano stops and everything
yeah.
and everyone looks at you like, can you imagine the sight of us as well, city kids? One of us is Dave Callan. They call him the poor man's Billy Connolly. I look like a poor man's Ellen DeGeneres. We all come walking into this Kellerberrin place. And his hat was like, this man's hat was like a leathery cowboy hat, but it wasn't like cowboy leathery. It was sort of kinky leathery.
Oh,
do you know what I mean?
What?
It was like shiny black leathery, somewhere between Wolf Creek and a dominatrix. Do you know what I mean?
Okay, yeah. Well, we know now.
Yeah, had some studs and that on it.
Okay.
It was peculiar and quite
intimidating. You may need to investigate that further.
And country pubs, yeah, John, there's always that big guy like that guy they called Donk in Paul Hogan's Crocodile
Donk.
Dundee.
Yeah,
Donk
yeah,
in
yeah.
the corner.
I don't need a gun. I've got a donk.
All right, so you missed this. We had a really funny incident in the Upper House. And you don't have a lot of funny incidents in the Upper House. But the WA Liberal leader, David Honey, was, you know, trying to make whatever point he was trying to make. And, well, he said this.
The member for the Kimberley said that she would fight like a Chichuana to retain regional representation. I stand corrected on the pronunciation of the dog. She would fight like a Chichuana.
Chihuahua?
They're fierce. She was going to fight like a Chichuana for...
A Chichihuahua.
A Chichihuahua. So he kept going. He kept
quite
saying
like
it.
Like a Chichihuahua.
And then he mispronounced pronunciation.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's come to my attention. The pronunciation of Chichihuahua, but what a liability he is now. He'll never speak again. What will they do with him?
A bit of a chumbawamba there.
They'll be having words with him before he goes.
Yes.
Like, listen, mate, don't say anything about the Chichihuahua, will you?
Maybe get a shih tzu or something. I don't know, something
yeah,
easy.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, God, no, you don't want him to mispronounce that. I swear him, won't
only one way to pronounce it. And I have one, so I'm good
it's
to go.
Have you got one? Have you got a shih tzu?
Well, she's crossed with a poodle.
She's crossed with a chihuahua?
No, she's...
she's crossed with a peodle.
Poodle crossed with a... what we just said.
Yeah. And what was your one? You can't do phenomenon, can you?
I have a bit of a problem with phenomenon.
Yeah, I have a bit of
more than one problem there.
Phenomenon.
But do you remember?
That's one.
Well, let's share this with John. Do you remember this from Team America?
Oh, no, this was an absolute classic.
Go on.
You see, the new world is inevitable.
It's what?
Inevitable.
One more time.
Inevitable! Things are inevitably going to change! God damn it, open your f***ing ears!
One of the great Kim Jong-il moments in Team America World Police.
It's a corker. My ex-wife used to have a ripper. There's some that you do. Oh, my stepdad's got some good ones.
Yeah.
Back in England, our Paul, he could never say chimney.
Oh, really?
Right?
Chimney?
Which is an easy word to say.
Yeah.
He used to say chimley with an L.
Oh,
chimley?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's like, look at that, there's smoke coming out the chimney. And he couldn't say jacuzzi either. He'd call it a kajuzzi. Isn't that adorable?
Well,
are you on holiday?
Dyslexia.
Have you got a kajuzzi there? Is there a nice kajuzzi?
That's like the kids with the hostel, John. We're going to go to the hostel.
He's down to the hostel. Yeah, he's got a and he started getting guitar lessons at one point off me mate Liam.
Yeah.
And it was around the time
that
it was around the time that Kings of Leon came out and he wanted to learn their songs on the guitar. And to this day he cannot separate that band from his guitar teacher. And he still calls them Kings of Liam.
Kings of Liam.
Kings of
Liam. That makes sense though.
And it's going nowhere.
Oh,
my ex-wife used to have one. You know when sometimes there's a word that you've only ever read and you've never heard it said?
Yeah.
And her one was adamant.
Adamant.
And she used to say adamant.
Adamant.
Oh, interesting.
And it'd come out at the worst moments as well. We'd be having an argument about something. She'd be like, why are you so adamant that you're right about it?
Well, I would rather
what
that.
Have you just said?
I'd rather that than the people who don't read and hear words and say words that they think they are and they're
right.
Nothing like it. Just watch any episode of Love Island. You'll be good to go on that one.
Sometimes if...
They don't know what it means.
Bit of research on it.
Yeah.
Maybe she just wanted to say the word damn, John. That was so the
perhaps.
Damn was in there, yeah.
Yeah, adamant does have more of a snap to it, doesn't it? Adamant. Yeah, why are you being so adamant about it?
Unplug the jukebox, right. Will you?
Well, listen, we will let you get back to, it'll be a full-cooked breakfast, I'd say.
Oh, at in Calabria.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know where anything is. I've already drank this motel out of coffee.
Right. Well, enjoy Tamman, and we hope Tamman enjoys you.
Send our love to Calabria as well.
Yep.
I certainly will.
More of this podcast in just a sec. 96 FM.
Time to talk sport with our man Ryan Daniels. Rhino, good morning, mate.
Hello, guys. Hi. How are we going?
How's life from the peephole?
How are you going?
Oh, wow. Well, I'm counting down the days. There's not long to go now. I think it's day 10. So I'm approaching the finish line. I can see it in the distance. It's blurry, but I'm sure it's there.
A little bit of light at the end of that tunnel. Well done.
Yeah, just a little bit.
It does look like a tunnel when you look through a peephole.
It does. You know, like, I think the people across from me now, I've been keeping an eye on them the whole week because... they're a couple. I think they're a young couple, I believe. They've come over together because there's twice the amount of food that goes in and out of that room. Now, I'm not quite sure what the details are. But I think they're moving out because there seems to be some movement over there this morning, which is sad because, you know, they've been the only people I've seen for the past 10 days.
You feel a certain closeness and... camaraderie.
They might feel differently. They may have seen me looking once or twice.
I get the feeling that's why they're moving, Ryan.
Maybe they're just moving rooms. They're probably not leaving.
They're going to the next level.
Get a piece of paper and write goodbye and good luck and poke it out underneath the door so that when they come out, they just see it. Make sure it faces them, not facing you. And then they'll see it when they come out.
That would be absolutely not stalkerish and creepy at all.
You're the one looking through the people and what they're eating.
My finger and write it in blood.
Right?
You've taken things too far. Let's talk about the grand final.
Maybe they're flying to Perth in readiness for a grand final. I don't know.
Let's talk about the Perth AFL grand final, shall we?
Optus.
Yeah. I think at this point, I mean, it's pretty obvious the momentum is building. It's getting pretty strong. A lot of plans being put in place, proposals put forward. I think this is going to happen. I now have very little doubt that it will. There's a couple of things that are still blocking it, and that's why we haven't seen an announcement. The biggest thing is the fact that there's a contract that we all know about that's with the MCG and the Victorian government and the AFL about hosting grand finals at that ground. Now, until that can be impossible with the COVID issues in Victoria, then they still have to keep that dream alive. And you have to imagine if you're the Victorian government and you're the MCG, you're still hoping that every day you'll wake up and there'll be zero cases and that lockdown can end on September 2. That's not going to happen. We all know how this works. There is momentum here. They had 57 cases again today. 30 of those are in the community. It's not looking good for Victoria. And WA is absolutely in the box seat. They're further along than any other state. Yes, South Australia and Queensland have shown interest in hosting the grand final, but they haven't had the meetings, they haven't had the infrastructure put in place, they haven't had the bookings made. This is what was happening last year with Queensland, and this is why it was already over before the bidding process started. Right. Now, WA is in that box seat this time, so it's a matter of time for me, and it's an exciting prospect. I don't know if you guys saw 7 News last night, but they were talking about the potential grand final parade, which may actually go down the Swan River. Which would be
interesting
a pretty
concept.
Pretty special sort of vibe. And I think a lot of that has to do with anything like a grand final parade these days, you have to have it COVID safe, which means you have to have people registering, which means you have to have sections lined up. So it would be a very different looking grand final parade, but we didn't even have one last year. So these are all the things that can be put in place in WA because it's such a safe environment. You can do a little bit more than you've been able to do in Queensland last year and definitely in the last 18 months anyway.
Okay. Well, when can we expect a decision?
Well, I think that'll come pretty soon. I mean, typically when a state is in lockdown, the announcement of when it might end or when it may not end usually comes a week, just about a week or slightly less under. Now, that would mean that you're probably looking at a decision from the Victorian government on lockdowns probably early next week, maybe Monday or Tuesday.
Right.
And once that has happened, then the finalisation with that MCG contract will happen, and then the AFL will announce their decision. Now, as I said, I believe that they have already made their call that if it can't be in Melbourne, that it'll be in Perth. But there are still just some I's to dot and some T's to cross. But once they are done, I expect WA to host the grand final. That's how strongly I feel now, which is extremely exciting for us, disappointing for Victoria, but somebody has to hold it. And the approach from WA's pitch was, we know where this is a custodian situation. Mm. We know that this is just for a year, and we want to do the best job we possibly can to leave it in our hands.
Okay. Well, mate, there are footy retirements every year, but a year with Eddie Betts and Bashir Hooley in the same year, it's a big deal, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I'll throw Sean Burgoyne in there as well. Those three guys, they've been obviously fantastic footballers, every single one of them. But I was thinking about this yesterday, and each of them, I think, has a really significant role to play going forward. I think Sean Burgoyne has been, in little bits and pieces, a fantastic media performer. We don't have enough Aboriginal footballers in the media and doing games as well. They provide really different perspectives. And Eddie Betts, I think, is one of the most beloved athletes we've ever had in the AFL. I think he has a really strong role to play going forward in helping Aboriginal footballers, helping clubs, helping the league itself in an ambassador role. And Bashir Hooley, for everything that he's done for his people, for you know what he believes in, and how to sort of make people feel okay about you know, all their biases in the past. I think he's a spectacular human being. I've been lucky enough to meet him twice. Mm. So I think all three of those guys going forward, we need to see more of them in different roles. And they've been fantastic footballers as well.
Yeah. Bashir Hooley's farewell yesterday to his teammates was phenomenal. And saying, you know, those times I wanted to come out and have a drink with you boys, but I just couldn't. And, you know, thanks for respecting my beliefs. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah. He obviously is a really unique individual within the AFL system, and he handled himself so well. And as I said, I don't think we've seen the last of any of those three guys.
The Eagles are undermanned.
They are. They're undermanned. It's felt like this all year for West Coast. They never seem to have a clean run at it. Jeremy McGovern, Josh Kennedy, Brad Shepherd, they're all out of the team that played last week against Fremantle. And, of course, it's a really important game. They have to win this game against Brisbane to have any hope of playing finals, and they also need either Essendon or GWS to lose their games. So there's a fair bit at stake. It feels like they're going in sort of on one leg and limping on that one leg, which is difficult. And it's not what you want to be when you've got your whole season on the line, but they've put themselves in this position with some of their other results in the past, particularly in the past sort of 6 to 8 weeks. Actually, I saw an interesting stat the other day. If you look at just the last 6 weeks, the Eagles are second last on the ladder for performance during that time.
Right.
Which is pretty stunning. I think Richmond actually are last. So it's a pretty incredible finish to the season in a negative way. Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Hey, it turns quickly, doesn't it, Rhino? You think about Richmond on grand final day last year. It turns so quickly when a team, all of a sudden it's past their time.
It does. And, you know, to hit that home, Mitch Woodcock, he does all the sorting of the tips for the West Australians.
Yeah.
And he sends this email out each week with the tips and says, you know, send them back. And I just always, you know, type in the tips and send them back straight away. And every week for the last 3 years, I've tipped Richmond. So this week I went to tip Richmond and went, oh, hold on a minute. No, they're going to lose. It was just my brain instinct went, no, Richmond always win.
Winners.
They're terrible now. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Just on the Eagles, Willy Rioli, obviously,
Pokey
like
pokey.
Earlier.
He's in, he's out, he's shaking it all.
He's got sore hamstrings.
Yeah, so I was told on Tuesday that he would play.
Yeah.
That he was going to play against Brisbane, that he'd done enough. He had some hamstring issues about 2 to 3 weeks ago, so they pulled him back a little bit. Mm. But in the last 2 weeks, he'd made up ground. He wasn't carrying anything serious into this week. The expectation was that he would play. And then, obviously, he's pushed himself at training this week and his hamstrings tightened up. Now, he's not in phenomenal physical shape, but he was in good enough shape to play. And that's disappointing for him. There's a few conspiracy theorists out there thinking that he was never going to play and the Eagles were playing ducks and drakes. But my information was that he was definitely in and he's out, as you say, at least the hokey pokey.
Yeah.
But he won't play. And there's still some chance. Obviously, if they make finals, he could play for them.
Yeah.
And he could also play waffle in the next couple of weeks if his hamstring recovers. So we'll see what happens.
All right.
There you go. So Andy Brayshaw back for the Dockers, heading to Hobart, mate. A bit of a mission for them.
Yeah, mission impossible, really, Claresy. So they're heading over there. Andy Brayshaw's obviously a massive inclusion. Adam Chera was very light duties at training yesterday, but I believe he'll play, which may or may not be his last game for the club. We'll see. Now, their equation is a bit more difficult than West Coast. They need the Eagles, the Giants, and Essendon to lose, and they need to beat St Kilda. I think they'll do their job, but I'm not sure all three of those teams ahead will lose. Interestingly enough, last time they played St Kilda in Tasmania was the Siren Gate game, which
isn't
was
that bizarre?
Which was a draw, which had to be revisited during the week, and obviously the points were given to Fremantle.
Yeah.
That was in Launceston. This one's in Hobart, but it's been a long time since they've played the Saints there.
Oh, that's right. It was a Chris Connolly era. I remember him storming onto the ground. Yeah,
it'll be
that's
cold in Hobart too. By the way,
it'll be freezing.
Pack
it'll
your
be freezing.
Warm undies.
Yeah, and Rhino, do we want to mention the Wallabies having a bad trot, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. And so this is an issue because New Zealand's had a couple of cases. So their border with WA might now be sort of a bit more difficult than it was before to navigate. So they're still trying to get that Bledisloe Cup game played at Optus Stadium. But there's some doubt over that. I believe it will happen. They're just organising how the bubble will look. And obviously the WA government has a lot of experience doing that because of the AFL teams that have been coming in and out constantly. So it'll be different for the All Blacks. They haven't really had anything like this to deal with yet, and it'll be different for the Wallabies. But I believe the game will still go ahead and there'll still be a crowd there.
Very nice. We'll just double check. We've done everything. Your neighbours at the hotel, grand final, retirements, Bledisloe, and the willy in and out. We've done it all. Well,
do you know when you're coming back to Perth?
Look, I'm hoping it's Tuesday. Obviously, things in New South Wales are pretty difficult. So I'm just like everybody else. I've got to go through the process.
Right.
I'm hopeful that I can get back and that I can be a normal human once I get there, but I don't know. It's still very much up in the air. I believe that border with New South Wales is closing tonight at midnight, so we'll see how we go. Hopefully I can see you guys in the flesh not too distant future.
Okay. All right, well, we look forward to it.
All right, mate, otherwise it's just your hologram and again next week, but fingers crossed, but all the best.
See you, Ryan.
Thanks, guys.
More of this podcast in just a sec. 96 FM.
Upper House debates are usually fairly, you know, boring for most of us.
Sorry, did I nod off?
You know, if you were so inclined as to watch, but this one was good fun. WA leader, Liberal leader, David Honey had a bit of an incident. Sometimes you get stuck on words, and he got stuck, he became tongue-tied trying to attempt to pronounce a popular dog breed. The member for Cottesloe came completely unstuck, quoting a Labor member who likened her resolve to a chihuahua's.
The member for the Kimberley said that she would fight like a chichuana to retain regional representation. I stand corrected on the pronunciation of the dog. She would fight like a chichuahua.
Chihuahua?
They're fierce. She was going to fight like a chichuahua
A chichihuahua, Madam Speaker.
He followed it up with the ultimate faux pas when you mispronounce pronunciation.
Yes, I know.
Because he said he mispronounced.
And he knew.
Instead of, mispronunciation.
Having such a crack at him.
Instead of pronunciation.
There's a lot of Labor members in there too.
David Honey, that was awesome.
Thank you, David.
Look, he isn't the only leader to get things wrong. I mean, where do we start with the list from Donald Trump?
Well, we'd be here all day, wouldn't we?
This is one of my favourites.
Shifting production to Thailand and to Vietnam. Thailand and Vietnam.
Oh, you got it right the second time.
Right.
So he actually knew. He had some awareness.
Thailand.
And you think he would have said Thailand with the I in there. AI.
Shifting production to Thailand.
Thailand.
And then, of course, there's Kim Jong-il. Well, okay, so this one's not real, but it is one of the great scenes from Team America.
You see, the new world is inevitable.
It's what?
Inevitable.
One more time?
Inevitable! Things are inevitably going to change. God damn it, open your ears.
No, I love the way you skimmed over it really quickly the third time. So good.
That is still one of my favourite movies ever.
Oh. But these people are not alone. It happens to all of us some stage.
I have a bit of a problem with
Which one? Which one?
Phenomena.
Lisa, that's phenomenal.
See, now, when you say phenomenal, that's...
It's easier.
It's the difference between phenomenon and phenomena.
Phenomenon.
I'm not too good with that.
You know my first radio job, right? I told you it was a 6MD in Meriden, right? Out in the wheat belt.
Yeah.
And I had to say Cool and Rural Supplies in my very first ad I read.
Cool and Rural.
That was the Cool and. That's in the place.
And Rural.
Cool and. And so I reckon I read it about 40 times because I was really nervous and really bad.
Rural's a funny word to
rural
begin
was
with.
My word.
Alone. I on its own.
And everyone's
it's
going,
anyone.
Oh, you've probably come to the wrong part of Australia if you're going to have to say rural a lot, buddy. Rural.
96 FM. The Bunch. Claire-Z and Lisa.